Rangitoto was one of the first places basalt was quarried from. The biggest of the quarries was the Auckland Harbour Board Quarry, which is shown here. The New Zealand Herald in October 1922 described the quarry in romantic terms. They said, "Lean men with rippling muscles, resourceful wives and sun-browned children live as gypsy within 9 miles of a hustling city. And yet, the peace of the wilderness with wallabies, possums and wild bees lifts the place to a certain level of romance." This is the Auckland Star from September 1927. And already there was becoming concern that Rangitoto was perhaps being exploited, that it should have been kept as a natural area, that it was a reserve and that's how it should stay. So this article, Destruction on Rangitoto, the Auckland Horticultural Society were worried about both the destruction by the animals that were on the island and the number of people who were now staying there. This is a photograph of Sarah Matthew, who was the wife of Felton Matthew, the first Auckland surveyor. This photograph was taken around about the 1860s, but she was in Auckland in the 1840s and was very definitely the first Pākehā woman to climb Rangitoto. So Auckland Libraries has diaries, journals and scrapbooks, and this one describes her day that she spent in approximately November 1841. "We were more than 3 hours in the ascent. The heat was excessive and not a drop of water was to be found all through that toilsome day. At last we reached the summit, all quite exhausted, and sat down to rest and breathe. But what a wonderfully extensive view we gained from this point. The sharp rocks and scoria had worn my boots to pieces, and my dress of grey merino was torn to shreds. Struggling through the thorny brushwood and the sharp edges of the rocks, thankful was I to see the shore and boat at last. We were all quite exhausted, and after a short rest, returned to Auckland."
Okay, this is one of our earliest maps we have for Rangitoto in our collection. This dates from 1891, so it's a plan of the Rangitoto Island Recreation Reserve. There are no roads, there are no footpaths, there's no wharves, there's nothing. This is just a bare blank canvas. Now, when Rangitoto was created to be a public reserve, the government vested the control and management of that island into the Devonport Borough Council, and it was called the Rangitoto Domain Board. This is the minutes of all their meetings. Obviously you've got a reserve and it's for the public, so people are going to want to visit this island, and naturally people are going to obviously want to go to the very top. The Rangitoto Domain Board, they agree that they need a footpath, but then they also have to decide to take that out to tender to see who's going to be responsible for building the footpath. These things take a long time to take place. So the track that was discussed at the very beginning of the book, way, way back in page 44, we finally get to the completion of the track. We move from 1892 to 1897 by the time they actually finish building it. And this is sort of says, well, we've completed the track. Well done, us.
So this image of old boots with torn sides and worn out soles, we've had that image on a glass plate negative in the collection for many decades, and we've always wondered a little bit why anybody would have taken a photo of boots. It just seemed a little bit unusual. And we've found the answer here in the New Zealand graphic from published on Saturday, the October the 9th, 1897, are three photographs, and these photos are also in the collection, of a group of young men who have walked to the top on the new path. And they're titled, "The First Party Up the New Track, Veterans of Rangitoto."
I was looking at our map collections and saw this one called Rangitoto Domain Board, Plan of Hutments. And hutments was kind of a curious word, and I was like, what were the domain board building hutments for? Obviously there's more increased tourism, there's increased activity on the island, and a properly formed road that could get equipment up and down the island was becoming more and more essential. They had actually done a deal with the government, they used prison labour to build the main road up Rangitoto. So what the domain board came up with were these huts. So basically these are relocatable huts. Literally this map is the instructions of how to put them together. So these little huts were constructed and designed by the Rangitoto Domain Board to solve the housing problem on Rangitoto for their labourers. In 1892, the Rangitoto Domain Board are approached by a member of the public who wants to mine salt on the island. It's actually interesting from this agreement, and there's some other later agreements to do with quarrying. Not so much quarrying as we think of it, where you're digging big holes in the ground, but they were for gathering loose shingle, as they called it. In actual fact, it was just the scoria. That they were not to disturb the vegetation, they were not to cut down any trees, they weren't to interfere with any of the animals on the island, and they also had to stick to the area the lease was for, so they weren't allowed to go outside those boundaries.
So one of the earliest sources of basalt in Auckland was from Rangitoto, and so built of Rangitoto stone, there was St Paul's Church, part of the St Matthew's Church also, the Mission House at Mission Bay, curbstones, just a lot of the curbstones around central Auckland, but also a lot of it just went as reclamation. The Harbour Board particularly used it to fill in the harbour. One of the wives of the quarry caretaker, Mary Houlihan, she was one of the early examples of the longest running industry on Rangitoto, which is the production of honey. So she had her own hives and her own label, won prizes with, because Rangitoto is the largest Pōhutukawa forest in the world. And so the honey coming from Rangitoto was quite pure Pōhutukawa honey. This is from July 1928, and we see a lot of examples of fur trapping. A naturalised resident of Rangitoto, various acclimatisation societies are now advocating for a closed season to protect opossums from indiscriminate slaughter. So we soon thought very differently about them, and in fact it took a long time through until 2011, when all the other pests that were on the island were finally eradicated.
These are the survey maps of Rangitoto Island that were produced in 1937. What's important about these is that they document every structure on the island as of 1937. So we can see on this map, this one's showing us basically the entire island. I love this bit here, which just says sort of very rough, broken scoria, rock country. Yeah, down here, we've got Rangitoto Wharf, but it's also all these little dots here essentially are showing the batches that were allowed to be put near Rangitoto Wharf. This track here, we're seeing that prison road that was being built in 1925 up to the summit, but of course it goes right the way around through to Islington Bay. We also, you can see industry on the island. So here, for instance, we're showing beehives, and there are also beehives over here in Islington Bay as well. This is yet another one of those survey maps. There's a whole set of these done. But what's cool is this side is showing the side of the island heading up towards Mackenzie's Bay and where the Rangitoto beacon would be. But what I like are some of the descriptions on this, like this one here, good picnic grounds. This is another map showing vehicle access and buildings on the island. But in this case, it's also showing you all the different boat sheds. So a lot of the batch owners, of course, would have had their own boats. So this is the last of the map series for the survey maps from 37. But what you can see, and you can still see it today, of course, is the outline of where the swimming pool was, the saltwater swimming pool. And so beside it, of course, if you're going to have a swimming pool, you could have bathing sheds, which, of course, today are the toilet facilities that are near the wharf, the old prison camp. You can also see the Boy Scouts had a scout hut on the island. St John Ambulance has a building on the island. But yes, the batches are a wonderful little sort of snapshot of iconic Kiwi life, getting away from it all.
In 1911, the Domain Board started issuing leases to camp, but in 1918, when they decided it was a better idea to have people build something a little bit more permanent. One of the reasons for this was to give the Domain Board money to further develop the island. So this volume of the Auckland Weekly News from May 1935 shows a lot of the happenings on Rangitoto at that time period. So we've got the swimming pool that the prisoners would have completed not long before this. We've got batches at Islington Bay, day trippers arriving by the ferry, and several photos of people who have made it to the summit. So this is the New Zealand Herald from April 1937. And by this time, the Minister of Lands had reviewed the leases on Rangitoto and decided that, in fact, people should never have built there. The leaseholders were given a 20 years to remove their batches. And that is what this article in the Herald is about. It's the owners' protest. In 1957, they were given another lease. It was for the lifetime of that leaseholder until 1990, when there was a moratorium on the destruction of the rest of the batches, at which point there were 34 batches left. It was decided that they had heritage value, and so those last 34 batches have remained. I know in the past people coming into Auckland by ship would say, you know, they knew they'd arrived home as soon as they saw Rangitoto, because it is such a feature of Auckland. Auckland has so many volcanoes, but not quite as distinctive as Rangitoto.
Auckland Council Archives, although we sound potentially scary, we actually are open to the public. So anybody who has a burning question about why a park has got a particular name, or why was that structure built by the council, those answers will be in this collection. And we have all sorts of stuff. We help provide the pieces to a jigsaw puzzle. We're one of many places you'll visit. So for instance, you might want to go upstairs and visit the Auckland Library's Research Centre or the Special Collections upstairs. But then what you find upstairs might bring you back down here, because maybe we've got the next piece of the puzzle. It doesn't matter how big or small your question is, we always welcome those questions from the public.
I've looked here at predominantly information that has come from newspapers and magazines, but the library also has a huge resource of manuscripts and photographs about Rangitoto, and of course books. So everything I've shown today can be seen in the Special Collections Reading Room. However, virtually everything has also been digitised, so it can all be seen online. Having said that, the library, of course, has kept the original and will continue to keep the original, because that is the source of all the information.